Today's lecture, we start a new unit operation, extraction. Okay, this extraction is also known as liquid-liquid extraction. In some cases or some textbook, you will see it's also known as solvent extraction. So here, what we have one phase, liquid phase. We add the second phase, which is also liquid. So essentially, we are talking in terms of L1 and L2. Okay, so one phase of liquid. Say, for example, contains A plus B or A plus C. One would be your, you know, feed containing, say, contaminant C, and we want to extract this C from A. So to do that, we bring another liquid, which we call it solvent. So we have the solvent phase, we have a feed phase, we add the solvent, make them, you know, agitate them, bring contact between the two phases, then extract C into the solvent. So when we have the mass transfer at certain rate, allow this liquid to settle the phase of A plus B plus C. Then we will see the phase separations. There will be two phases, or these two phases are liquids. So we have L1 and L2. One is extract, so essentially solvent which you have added, B, has extracted C into this. So that phase will contain, you know, B, a large amount of B solvent, and all the C from A, or most of the C from the feed phase, has gone into that phase. We have the second phase, all right, we will call it raffinate. Remember, we use this word extract and raffinate in the first introductory lectures we had on the cascades or stage wise. So here now we have the raffinate, which will contain, you know, like it's a residue that will contain a small amount of C in A. Okay, so essentially, try to understand the difference between this unit operation extractions with the previous two unit operations which we discussed, absorption and distillation. In absorption, we also have A plus, say, B, right? Say air contains sulfur dioxide, so two components and one phase. What we did, we brought in this phase with a new phase, liquid, water, all right? Water doesn't contain any sulfur dioxide. It's for simplicity. So we are bringing another component and another phase here, and then sulfur dioxide is getting transferred. So at the end of the day, we have two phases, gas phase and the liquid phase. Gas phase contains less amount of C, sulfur dioxide, and the bottom product, you know, which is spent liquor, spent liquid in this case, contains large amount of sulfur dioxide. So one phase brought in contact with the second phase, new component. And then we have this separations. The mechanism here is solubility. All right. Then we talked of distillations. We have liquid phase, the feed, or we can have vapor phase. Now we talked about in the previous lectures Q line, different values of Q, etc. So we can have a liquid or vapor, contains two components, A and B. How do we separate? We don't bring any third component. We give energy, heat. So essentially, you have this distillations. Now you have two phases. Top product, say it's vapor phase, of course it can be condensed as a liquid, and then bottom you have this liquid phase. Both contains A plus B and A plus B. There is no C here. But in the top product, we have a large amount of A, very small amount of B, and the bottom we have a very large amount of B and a small amount of A. What is the mechanism of separation? Relative volatility. So depending upon the volatility of A with respect to B or vice versa, we have now this separations. Okay? So the difference between absorption and distillations is, one, we can see that in case of absorption, we brought in a new component, C, in the form of water. And we have the two-phase gas and liquid. In case of distillations, we do not bring any third component. We bring energy. And then we separate by some mechanism. Extraction, what we have? We have a liquid contains two components, say A plus C, carrier, bulk phase, you know, bulk amount, and we have C contaminants, and we have been asked to separate. For some reason, we can't use distillations, because when we give energy, possible that the mixture of A plus C degrade, decompose. So distillation will not work. We don't have a new solvent which is going to have different solubility for C. So absorption will not work. So what will work? Let's try extractions. So extraction, what we have? A plus C. Now we are an A and C, let's say C is soluble, miscible in A. How do we remove? we bring another solvent B, which is immiscible with A but miscible with C. So what we B will do, we'll bring A plus B plus C in contact, agitate, mix them, allow for the mass transfer, and then allow them to settle. So separations, when we settle, now we will get two liquids, immiscible liquids. So they will separate by the mechanism of density difference. That's only for the settling. But C has been now distributed between the top phase and the bottom phase. Both are liquid. So one phase, but we are saying that's L1 phase and L2 phase, extract and the refinant. Now C is getting distributed. What is the mechanism here? Difference solubility in two phases, right? C solubility in A is different from solubility of C in the solvent which you are trying to add. So we have mechanism of separation is solubility difference, but still we have two phases, L1 and L2. May not be like liquid and vapor, not like liquid and gas. It's L1 and L2, two immiscible liquids. Very often it happens in case of organic and inorganic solvents. We'll talk about those examples later. So let's try to understand again. We have A plus C, we bring B, C distributes, maybe in the extract, it's a very large quantity, 98%, and in this bottom, this residue or this refinant phase, we have very small amount of C. So here we are adding a third component, similar to absorptions, all right? But now here the difference is that now the C is getting distributed in A and B by different mechanisms. There's a distribution coefficient, there's a partition coefficient, etc. All right. So let's see what will be our strategy to address this type of unit operations. We'll take some examples, industrial examples, you know, where you have separations. If you remember in the first few lectures also, we talked about, when we were discussing about cascades or stage wise, we said nicotine, water and kerosene. So water contains some nicotine solubles, all right. Nicotine is injurious to health, carcinogenic compound. We have been asked to treat this wastewater, potable water, whatever water. So maybe for some reason we can't use distillations, maybe for some reason we can't use absorptions or desorptions to desorb nicotine. But we have this extraction, we bring a solvent, kerosene. This kerosene can extract nicotine, right? Because nicotine has larger solubility in kerosene than in water. So here there is an analogy between, you know, different unit operations, and there is a difference also between the different unit operations. So let's just sum up here before we address this extractions. So today's lecture, we begin a new unit operation, extraction. It's also known as liquid extraction or LL extraction or just LLX, or in some cases you will see it's called solvent extraction. All right, all of them, they are very similar. And you know, just for our record or for our understanding, absorption, we had typically gas phase. So we have phase one, two component system, say A plus B, air and sulfur dioxide. We have been asked to remove, separate B from A. What we have done, we bring liquid, different phase, say component C, water. And now we have this separation, two phases by mass transfer. One phase is gas, one phase is liquid. Gas contains A and some B, but B is very small amount. Liquid contains the C, water, but very large amount of, large concentration of B, spent liquid. So here addition of liquid third component, here we have added third component. All right, and then we have mechanism here, you can write it's a solubility. Here what happened in case of distillation? We have say liquid phase or vapor phase, you know, feed, we talked about Q line, etc. And both of them say contains A and A plus B, either liquid or vapor. So that's our feed. And we want to separate B from A or A from E. What we do? We add energy. It's not a third component. So here, you know, we are adding L, here we add energy, heat. All right. This heat causes separations. We have vapor phase and we have this liquid phase. Both vapor phase contains A plus B. See, notice the difference, A plus B here and C plus B. Now, water can also evaporate into this gas phase, but if you neglect this evaporation of water, which should happen, then you have this gas plus liquid, A plus B and C plus C. In distillation, you have A plus B and A plus B, except here A is more volatile, then A will be very large, and in this case B will be very large. So, we have 99.99%, we saw those examples in the earlier class, and we here we have this liquid which will be rich in B or very poor in this A. What is the mechanism here? Mechanism is relative volatility. And we have phase 1, phase 2, phase 1 which is a gas phase and phase 2 which is liquid. We have phase 1 for the vapor, phase 1 for this liquid. The difference is here we are adding energy, here we are adding a third component, water. All right, let's see what happens in extraction. Okay, very simple example. We have phase. So, phase is one thing, component is another thing. So, we have a liquid phase. It contains two components, A plus C. Typically, A will be large, C will be small. We will call this C as solute. A will call it as carrier. All right. But more important is that we have phase, or some phase, liquid phase here. And we have been asked to separate C from A. What we do here? Now we add another phase and another components here. So we are adding a liquid, say B, different component, we call it solvent. So one, this liquid is being added to the second liquid. Now C and A, they are miscible. Solubilized, but the one we are going to add here, B, must not be miscible in A, or it should be partially miscible in this. So, we will talk about the phase diagram or the different systems, system 1, type 1, type 2, etcetera, where it is possible, you know, different scenarios, situations are possible. So, right now we are saying that we are adding a solvent to extract this C, and this component B is insoluble in A. All right. Now, when we do this, we bring in contact, we have agitation, etcetera. Now, we separate and then we have allow them for set to settle. We will say we can visualize, you know, we have taken A plus C, we have added B, we stir them for sufficiently long time, allow them to settle. We will have two liquids, two distinguished liquids. They are separated now by densities. Heavier liquid will settle here, lighter liquid will settle on top of it. All right. Visually, you can, you should be able to see that there are two phases, L1 and L2. This L1 will typically will contain, say you have B extracts solvent. So, most of B has come here and it will carry with it large amount of the C. All right. There may be some amount of A here also. So, right, we said that earlier that there are different types of, you know, systems, etcetera, type 1, type 2. But typically what we are trying to say here that both L1 and L2 will contain B plus C plus A, all three of them, A plus B plus C. So, now B is a solvent, it picks up C, very large amount of B, large amount of C, but a small amount of A can also go here. We will call this as extract. So, extract because we have very large amount of solvent. B is extracting it as a solvent. So, very large amount of B and most of C has gone here. Okay. This guy will also, this L2 phase will also contain A plus B plus C. We will expect that now we have very large amount of A, which was our feed, and very small amount of C here, because most of C has gone here. Alright, and it's possible that some B will also get in, although very small amount. So what we have, extraction at the end of the separations or equilibrium, we have two phases. Both phases contain A plus B plus C, L1, L2, and these two phases are immiscible. Altogether, we have new types of a fluid mixture, A plus B plus C, A plus B plus C, but two are totally distinct and different. Other than this density difference, we have different amounts of A plus B plus C. L1, we call it extract to signify that this contains very large amount of solvent. The solvent has picked up C, most of the C, but it contains A also. Similarly, this L2, we call this as a raffinate or residue. So, this is the second product. This will contain, you will expect, carrier, this large feed, and a very small amount of C. But some B will also get carried away. Right? So, both are A plus B plus C. But in one case, we have extract solvent, it has taken away with it most amount of C, and the second phase has feed A, which you wanted to purify, you wanted to remove the C out of this, it will contain some amount of C, and there will be some carryover B. So, there is a partitioning of A, B, C in both phases. Alright. So, this is the difference, try to appreciate the difference between this unit operation extraction from the previous two which we discussed, absorption and distillation. Here the mechanism is also about solubility, but make a notice, the solubility is not just about C, we are talking of now solubility of all three components A plus B plus C. To what extent there is a carryover of B in this? To what extent there is a carryover of A, and of course, partitioning of C, larger solubility in this extract phase, and a very small amount of carryover of C in this raffinate phase. Right? So, the solubility is mechanism, and see the difference between this absorptions. What we did in case of absorptions, we had A plus B, or say A plus C, air and sulfur dioxide. We added B, water, two phase. And this contains two components. This is a pure component here, liquid, gas and vapor, but look at the separations. We have A plus C, very small amount of C, but now we have B and plus C. It's a gas phase, it's a liquid phase. Unlike here, we have clear partitionings between the two phases, which are liquids, L1 and L2, immiscible, you can see the difference, you are adding a solvent to liquid, one liquid to another liquid to have a separation between two different types of lipid, but all both of them L1 and L2 contains A, B, C, A, B, C. Alright. It's a very popular unit operations used in several industrial applications. Alright. So, this is the introduction for extractions. Before we go, you know, many far, you must understand the difference between extraction and the previous two unit operations from mechanism point of view or from the phase, what phases we are talking, what components. By default, extraction is a ternary, it is a three components mixtures we are talking of. We have two phases, both contains A plus B plus C, A plus B plus C. Unlike in the previous two cases, distillation, of course, absorptions, we talked of mole fractions of A and B, XA 1 minus XA, XB 1 minus XB. Here we have to talk in terms of XA, XB and 1 minus XA minus XB for C, for both phases, extract and the raffinate. So, there is a difference, there is a similarity in both cases. Alright. Now, let us take some examples, you know, industrial examples of extractions. This is also very quite popular, especially in petroleum or refining industries. Okay, in refining industries, you have distillation column. If you happen to visit one of refinery industries, you will see main heart of distillation column is heart of the plant is distillation column. You have feed crude oil liquid, and then you distill and you fractionate. You have different types of products. You know, you have at the top you have very light gas methane ethane coming out of it, C1 C2. Then you have naphthene. You can have kerosene, right? Kerosene, naphthene. Then maybe heavier liquids like paraffins, lube oils. So there you are trying to separate by distillation change in the relative volatility. But to the bottom products, which is lube oil, very heavily, its extraction becomes very popular here. There you have to extract by making use of this change in the solubility of one component in other components. All right. So let's just note down one or two examples of extraction. So the examples, let's take, we have acetic acid. All right, AA. And we have water. All right, so these two are miscible. Let's call this A, let's call this as C. So typically we have solute represented by C. So water contains some amount of C, small or large, that's not important right now. All we are saying that they are miscible. We add ethyl acetate, all right, ethyl acetate also known as ether. So we add B. Ethyl acetate is insoluble or partially miscible in B. Okay. And so we mix the two, we have agitation, allow for settling. So typically this extraction, you will see it is represented by a tank for agitation, and then you say that you have a settler, just like this. So entire extraction, you know, from the principle of operation contains two large vessels, one for agitation, one for mixing, where you have this A plus C and you have added B, allow them for some time, then bring to the next vessel where you allow them to settle. So you will have two phases, lighter and the heavier. All right. So going back to this example of acetic acid within water, and you are adding ethyl acetate or ether, you have two products, L1, L2, both are liquids, but they are immiscible. They are immiscible. L1, we call it extract for the reason we are using this ethyl acetate as a solvent. So this will contain, you will expect most of ethyl acetate, ether will come here. This will contain very large amount of C, acetic acid, which is your solute. You wanted to purify this water from acetic acid. It's a very common example. Water contains acetic acid in some applications, right? So B plus C, it's a very large amount of C, but there is a very small amount of A as well. Okay, so water is now also partitioned into this B plus C plus A. You have L2, call it raffinate for the reason, or residue for the reason that this feed A, most of water has come here from which we wanted to remove the C. So there is some amount of C here, very large amount of C here, but there is some amount of B, ethyl acetate or solvent here also getting carried off. It's a very good example, typical example of extractions. How do we separate acetic acid from water? We use ethyl acetate and separate them like this. We can't use distillation because there is a risk of this acetic acid getting decomposed there. Although it's possible that there is a relative volatility, a difference in the volatility between the two components. We are trying to say that if we use A plus C in distillation, then what we will get, there is no B there, we don't have to add any B. We will, if we can do that, we will have a vapor phase that will contain large amount of A, small amount of C. We will have another phase, we will contain small amount of C, a very large amount of this. If we will have absorption, if we can use absorption, then of course, again we will add. So, this is one phase liquid. So, actually instead of absorption, we should use the word desorption. If we can find a, you know, solvent like a steam we used in the previous examples for absorptions. So, for this A plus C, maybe we add another component B, and then we will have situations like A plus C, but we will have also B plus C. So, you notice it is not A plus B plus C, not this is A plus B plus C here. Alright. So, in this case, because of the limitations of whatever relative volatility or finding a new type of solvent, we have extractions, works very nicely for this. As I said earlier, there are several examples. Petroleum, for your understanding, it is recommended that you go through the textbook Trebol or the book by Datta, and you know, go through some of the very common typical examples which is you find for in petroleum industries or pharmaceutical industries or even food industries. So, these are some of the examples you will find for petroleum. Of course, as we said, you know, the very extensive use of extractions in separating a number of components from lube oil or paraffins, waxes, etcetera, it is very extensively used in such applications. Pharmaceuticals, you know, PCS compounds, say like say vitamins, you know, B12, you know, maybe penicillin, erythromycin, amoxicillin, etcetera, one can use, make use of this extraction to extract vitamins B12 or these pharmaceutical compounds from biofluids. So, it is used very extensively. Food industries, you know, extraction of certain juice, etcetera, you cannot use distillation because all this, you know, all these items, you know, quantities, they will decompose. All right. So, extractions works very nicely. It is recommended you make use of several examples in the textbook by Trebol or by Datta. So, we begin first with thermodynamics. Our approach is same what we had adopted for absorption and distillation column. One has to establish liquid equilibrium. Alright, just like in case of absorption, we started with absorption, Henry's law. So, there has to be some equilibrium curve y versus x, given this y so much is x, given this x so much is y. Here also we have liquid equilibrium. For case of distillations, we also we have y versus x based on Rawls law. Alright, we fix the temperature, fix the vapor pressure and then fix the two compositions. Alright. So, here also we need to have liquid equilibria. So, essentially we have A plus C feed solute or carrier. C and A, they are completely miscible. We bring in contact with B solvent. Alright. B is immiscible or partially insoluble in partially soluble in A. Alright. We have this mixing, then settling. We separate as two phases, two immiscible liquids, extract, but both of them are ternary mixture, unlike we had handled binary mixtures. So, here we will expect extract B plus C, very large amount of C and a small amount of A. In this case, you will expect feed, small amount of C and some small amount of B as well. All right. and what mole fractions we use here or what nomenclatures we use here is, first is X, or we work on mostly weight fractions. This becomes more convenient in extractions than on the mole fractions. Of course, mole fraction will also work, but generally typically we have this weight fractions. So we have X defined as C over C plus A plus B. So now you should be able to notice the difference between the extractions and previous, you know, absorption or distillation as far as our mathematical treatment is concerned. And we make a note here that therefore this is a ternary mixture. Both phases, raffinate and extract, they are ternary mixtures. So we have X, C over C, A plus B in raffinate. We will use Y as C over C plus A plus B extract. There is no obvious reason why we are using X for raffinate and Y for extract. But traditionally is vapor phase, which is lighter, we use Y. The one which is liquid, you know, heavier, we use X. So maybe there is a reason that extract in all the textbook is represented by Y, and raffinate we have a representation with X as a weight fractions. So we are going to use X and Y. Similarly, one can also use X prime, which we will call it as a solute free weight basis. So again here notice, this is not the first time we are using this solute free basis. In previous also we had this type of representation when we discussed when we discussed absorption, then we also discussed solute free or solvent free basis. So now we have X dash, which is solid free basis, that means this is C over A plus B raffinate. So notice the difference here. Solid free basis, some of the computations becomes quite simpler if we work on this solid free basis. Similarly, we will have Y prime, which is C over A plus B, no C here in the denominator, and we have this extract. There is one way of representation also by solvent free basis. Alright. Here we use capital X. You should recall discussion on absorptions, which is C. Now this would be A plus C. So no solvent. Remember, we had B as a solvent, A as a feed, C as a solute, contaminant which you want to separate, and we added B as a solvent. So this is solvent free basis nomenclatures, capital X as C over A plus C. So corresponding to this we have Y, C over A plus C, alright. So we have extract, and this is also, this is raffinate. So these are the three very common ways of representing this mole weight fractions. One is simple X, another is solid free basis, and the third is solvent free basis. Right. More important here, now you should realize that, appreciate that now since we have three components, we require a different special type of graph, which is equilateral triangular coordinate system, based on equilateral triangular coordinate system. Because now every time we have to discuss in terms of three components, A, B and C. That's the default of this extractions. So if you go to nearest your bookstore, or you can download from the internet, your equilateral triangular coordinate system or the graph for extraction will look like this. And the reason is only one, it's A plus B plus C. The traditional coordinate system or the graph which we had, X versus Y, like the lines like this, like this, like this, and the vertical lines like this, like this, like this, will not work or may not work, because here we had only two components, A and B, but now we are talking in terms of A plus B plus C, three components. Okay, so as I said earlier, you know, you go to your next bookstore, you can go to the internet, can also download this type of graph. this graph, you will see lines like this. So equidistant lines like these. All right, and then here you will see lines like this. This is also equidistant. Qualitatively, we can draw like this, all parallel lines to each other. Okay, and then we have now third line going like this. This is also parallel lines. Excuse me, if you are making a mistake here in drawing these lines. So these are all triangle lines, okay, connecting like this. Here also we will make a connections like this, all parallel lines here like this. And then we have the representations. Say we have the apex for A, for B and for C. Okay, so you know, before getting into the details, when we write A, B, C like this, here we have 100% A, we have 100% B, we have 100% C. So right now let's stay away from the, you know, extractions or this partial miscible or immiscible or phase separations. Let's try to understand the physical representation of different coordinates on this space equilateral triangular coordinate system. So equilateral means all this equilateral triangle, three sides are the same, and now we will see the axes like this, unlike here, you know, this Cartesian coordinate system. And when you write here 100% A, 100% B, then you will see some scale here, say 10, 20, 30, 40, 60, etc. All right, so this will be level, say 20, or you have 60, 80, things equally distance, right, like this. So when we say 60 here, 60% or 0.6, we are saying that if we written like this, that means B is 0.6 here. So A is 100% as you go along in this directions, A amount of A decreases and B is 100% here. There is no C on this. Similarly on this, you will see the level, say 10, say here if you see 40, all right, all it means, or this could be in some textbook, you will see that it is a reverse like 60 or 90 here. So you should be careful that when you are writing like this, A is 100% here. So when you march in this direction, A is less and C is more till C becomes 100% here. So this 40 represents 40% of C and 60% of A. So A increases in this direction and C decreases in this direction. Similar argument for B and so it's required that you become familiar for this. So take this example, a general example of A, B and C here, equilateral triangle. So we have say this graph for A, B, C, it's level, all right, and we choose a arbitrary positions here K, and if we are asked to find out what is A, B and C in this case, right. So what should be the representations? A here is 100%, B here is 100%, C here is 100%. On this line, there is no B. On this line, there is no C. On this line, there is no A. Right. So in this graph, how much amount of A, B, C, if we take this horizontal line and read either from here and from here, the C increases in this direction, whatever we read the reading from here, that will be given by for C. Let us say C is 20%. How much amount of B? We take just parallel to this, we take line passing through this B, we read from here, this will be given by B here. Let us say this is 25% or 20%. Okay. So, all we are trying to do here is trying to read this graph. If you ask to find out what is B here, you take a line parallel to this AC. What is C here? Take a line parallel to this AB, because C is 0 here.
B is 0 here, and then B increases in this direction, C increases in this direction. How much is A? A is 0 here. So, read the line passing through this on this scale. So, whatever you read here, that will represent C. So, how much is A? 100 minus this, 20, 20, 40, this is 60. Here also you read 40, because the rest would be 60% here for A. So, be careful with the reading. Sometimes they, as you said earlier, they increase. So, this is A is 100% here. So, you will see a reading in this increasing order. That means it is about C. If you see the reading in this, that it is about A. So, since B is 20%, C is 20%, A is 60%, 100 minus 20, 20. On the graph also, you will be able to read the same numbers. So, what is amount of A? We have taken this line here like this. Okay. For what B, we have taken a line like this. So, here you will read for the 60%, this will be read as 40%, because that's for C. So, 100 minus 40 is for your C here. All right. So, how, before we take another example here, we must try to understand that how this graph has been prepared, just for our understanding. And the way this graph has been prepared, it is actually based on the principle of equilateral triangle. So, recall your knowledge from your coordinate geometry or some elementary geometries, that if you have equilateral triangle and we choose any coordinate here, draw the perpendicular on this, on this, on this, summation of all three altitudes will be constant. That means, if this is k and we represent here, let us say as c, for this is a, because a is pure here, a is 0 here, and for this if we use b, then k a, segment k a, k b and k c, summation of all this will be constant and same as the altitude of this triangle. If you choose any point here, you draw the perpendicular to the three sides, measure the three segments, summation of all three will again be same as h. That means, it is telling us that since we have 100%, if we want to distribute A, B and C, equilateral triangle can be used to represent the different amounts of A and B and C. Why? Because anywhere the amount of A plus B plus C is 100%. A plus B plus C is 100%, A plus B plus C is 100%, because sum of all three altitudes is same as h here. Then based on this, one can construct the graph, one can prepare the graph, you can take parallel line this, distribute BC into equal number of segments, distribute AB into equal number of segments, distribute AC into equal number of segments to prepare this kind of equilateral triangle. All right. So, this also maybe you can try as an exercise to convince yourself that altitudes are the same. As a consequence, one can draw this equilateral equal amount of the segments here. Okay. Now, let us do something more here. Again, let us start with this equilateral graph or this equilateral triangle here. A 100% here, apex or B representing 100% or B. Apex C representing 100% of C. As you said, any amount, any point if you choose here, D, C is 0. In this line, C is 0. How much is A and B? That depends upon the segment ratios. It is all about mixing rule, all right, which we have done so many times in case of distillations, even absorptions. A plus B, we add D. How much is the mole fraction of B? Or A 1 minus XB, that depends upon how much amount you have added. All right. So, this locus for D, if you recall in a previous A by B, this is nothing but XD over 1 minus XT. Okay. So, how much is the amount of A and B in this mixture of D is this segment. So, the way the graph has been plotted, this is 100% here, this is 0% here. So, increasing going in this direction, B become increases, A decreases. So, A by B, amount of A and B which have been added to prepare this mixture of D will contain mole fractions or the weight fractions of D in the ratios of this length BD, which is 1 minus XT, sorry, which is this XT here, and then you have this AD here, right. Similarly, if I use add this A and C and obtain this mixture here of A and C, how much amount of C and A is here? C will be the ratios of this segment to this segment. It's all about mixing rule or the tie rule we applied here. Now let's say that we connect this line CD and we say that in this mixture of A and B we have added certain amount of C and we obtain this mixture. Let's not worry about the phase separations, whether miscible or immiscible, just the species balance or the mixing rule. In a mixture of A and B we add C, all right, and to obtain this locus here. So what does this K represent? K represents that whatever mixtures we have prepared of A and B is now like say represented by D, hypothetical mixture. In D we have added, the resulting mixture of K has to line on this operating line. This is what we said in case of enthalpy, absorption, any space we apply this mixing rule of A and B, the resulting mixture of C has to lie on this straight line connecting between A and B. You directly apply the total balance, you apply the species balance to convince yourself that the locus of this line is a straight line. And on this C will fall depending upon how much is the amount of C you have added here. Alright, so if you take this point K here, all it means how much amount of C is added, the ratios of this to this. Okay, if I have the locus here, choose this, suppose this point here K prime, how much is C is added here, this ratios about this segment. It is all about as if we have A and B mixture and we have added a component C here. You go all along this line, here now C becomes 100%, okay, A and B is 0 here. You come all the way this here, here now C is 0 and you have mixture of A and B, okay. Again all this understanding, you know, comes from one mixing rule. You add the two mixtures. So how much is C by D in this case? It is all about XC and 1 minus XC. So from this line if you read, draw a horizontal line, C is 0 here. So you will read from here. Say you read from here, this is XC. So C by D is XC by 1 minus XC because C increases in this direction. So this coordinate is XC. This segment is 1 minus XC. So C by D, amount of C by D will be equal to X by 1 minus C. By writing all this species balance, the total balance, one can, you should be able to convince yourself the meaning of this. Alright. We take one more example here. Again we start with this equilateral triangle or this equilateral graph, ternary graph. We have A, we have B, we have C, okay. Again it is all about the mixing rule. If we choose one R and E here, let's call it R, let's call it E, okay. Of course R may signify for raffinate, E for extract, but let's not worry about of we are talking in terms of phase separation. We are trying to understand the meaning of this ABC, the coordinates on this ABC, what does it reflect. So if we take R and E and we say that the mole fraction of this mixture R is XC, XR, mole fraction of C solute in this extract or E is XC, if we add the two, we have the new mixture M, which will have the mole fraction for C as XM, and this has to be on this straight line connecting between R and E. That is about the mixing rule, M equals R plus E. Anytime you have addition, the equations like M equal to R plus E, M XM equals R XR plus E XE, one can show that the ratios of R by E will be equal to XM minus XE over XM minus XR. So let's try to understand this. We have E here, we have R here. Take the line here, all right. Say L, say this is M here. We have O here. Let's take this projections here as D, connect this, call it S, call it P. All right. So what we have written here is R by E. The amount of raffinate and amount to the ratios of amount of E is nothing but the ratios of XM minus XE. So XM minus XE and we have XM minus XR, all right. is like a tie rule, R xm minus xr equals e into xm minus xe. So essentially we are saying there is nothing but the line EP, xm minus xe is the line EP over line PS. This is the line PS, xm minus xr. This has to be the same as line ME, line ME over line RM. All right. So the same about similar argument about this mixing rule. Add E and R, you get B. How much is the ratios of R and E in this phase? It's about this segment. Ratios of RM over ME. All right. So, and then this will also be equal to the ratios of these two segments based on, you know, the property of this two in a triangle with two parallel lines. So these small calculations, given the textbook Trebol also, you should be able to convince yourself. But it's all about the mixing rule, irrespective of the state of the two phases, whether miscible, immiscible. If I choose any two coordinates here, R and E, with the composition of XR and XE, and mix and ask for what is the mixture composition XM. This XM will be given by the ratio of the two segments, or given the ratios, given the mole fractions, the segment, the amount of R and E will be decided by this ratio of the two segments, and this line has to be on this straight line connecting R and E. So the same argument we had in case of distillations, here also we say that for this ABC phase, we have similar applications. All right.